speak confidently for all of Roski to say that we're very grateful to have Tia Sabela Grimes with us today. Grimes is a choreographer, writer, composer, and educator, currently assistant professor of practice at the USC Gloria Kaufman School of Dance. Grimes's work is more than multidisciplinary. It's pedagogical, physical, metaphysical, and keenly aware of urgent social issues as it examines invisible histories and constructions of race and sexual identity. Urgencies that have served as catalysts for various projects include the death of Trayvon Martin and the fight for legal justice, as well as the alarming rates of incidences of police brutality in the U.S. Combining pedagogic and artistic inquiry with a concern for the way bodies connect, Grimes has created a movement system called Funkamentals, developed from his studies of the culture of the African diaspora, and in particular, the methodical dance training and community building elements evident in Black vernacular and street dance forms.
Boom.
And I got that off of your faculty page. So I figured that one was spot on. Sabela's background in dance, Afro diaspora cultural practices, hip hop sound production, speech and writing, combined with his active engagement with what he calls the Sidewalk University, have created work that truly electrifies both minds and bodies. In addition to his choreographic work, Grimes often materializes his practice in the form of workshops and lectures in schools, museums, and other public sites. The work thus seems to constantly evolve, physically and psychologically shifting along with its different social environments.
Okay.
Grimes received a BA in English
and
an MFA in dance and choreography from University of California, LA, and was a 2014 United States Artist Rockefeller Fellow.
Got a check. Cool. Yeah, we gotta get it cracking right from the gate. Thank you, Carmen. It's just in the spirit of gratitude, I just want to thank you all for coming this evening. I'm Dee Sabela Grimes. My mama calls me Delvin, aka Open Soul 7, aka Twice Born, aka Peanut Butter Yellow Almost Red, Thicker Than Most, aka Tehudi Stock, aka the Sonic Archivist, and that's what we're gonna talk about a little bit today. So I didn't prepare anything, but I'm always prepared to be in the moment, and I'm glad you all are here to share in this moment with me. Is it okay if I just kind of just share with you what's like ruminating in my creatrix?
Yeah.
So just to let you know, this might be inappropriate to say in the hallowed halls of the academy, but I came to articulating what I do using the vocabulary that we're given in the academy a little bit later in life. So I have a tendency to use the language that I learned when I got my enduring PhD at Sidewalk University. So if there's anything that I say that doesn't translate, just holler at your boy and say, okay, this is what it is, this is what I'm talking about. And we'll just go down that road. Also, I learned when I was in graduate school and a little bit when I was on the road with Bringing Hair's Peer Movement, and since I've been doing my own work, to use that word, work. But that really doesn't come to me natively, intuitively, to call what I do work. Nor have I ever been in a sort of situation that I wanna, bring in a sort of Marxian language to, make sure that you understand that the artist has labor in his head. You better rock them white shoes. So if I don't say work, I'll say something like, this is what I'm playing with, this is what I'm feeling right now, this is where I'm going with this. In the words of Duke Ellington, I don't know if you guys ever seen this interview that he does, and he's sitting at the piano, and the guy says, oh, so So, you know, when you compose, he's like, oh, I'm not. He's like, oh, you play the piano? I'm not playing the piano. This is dreamy. So I use a lot of that crazy language, yeah? And but if work works for you, work. Okay, anyway. So check this out. This is where I'm at in the game right now. I ask a question, this is gonna be so much about process, all right? So any and everything I do, like I live in the process, let's just be clear on that. So when I teach the lecture course, it's not a part or separated from what I do creatively or as an artist. Some of the Cypher members from my movement class are here and they could pretty much attest to that. I'm sure you weren't expecting to see a different person. I was gonna be like, well, it might work in the pedagogical if that's your thing, bless. So I ask a question at the beginning of a class or a course that I teach called Hip Hop Don't Stop, Exploring Black Vernacular Dance Practices. So the first question I ask is, if you don't own the body, can you own what the body produces? If you don't own the body, can you own what the body produces? And then I go on to talk about a certain sort of matrix, right? This sort of sphere of influence, both material and immaterial. We go through the intersections and of course all the themes, race, gender, blah, blah, blah. And then later on, I hit them upside the head with a question. So they begin to just think about, the goal is for them to think about black bodies in the experience here, primarily in the United States of America. Ideas or constructed ideas or given ideas or programmed ideas of what production is. And then we begin to dream on, you know, and really, I mean, it's like, can you dream, can you envision that that's not the only matrix? Like, there are other worlds that are within this world that people inhabit. So, it's a little crazy. You guys should, maybe we should all go over my house at the end of the semester and read the the evaluations. It's always fun. Because it's a lot to think about. What usually happens over the course of the semester, some people realize that they really were unconsciously felt like they had access to black cultural product, and they weren't conscious of it, i.e. black bodies in a variety of different ways. And so the reason I share that with you is because I go on later and ask the question, is black dance created for non-blacks? And so I asked this question yesterday, and the majority of the students were like, no. And what's really interesting is then I ask, are you okay with that? For the non-black students, and they're like, yeah. I'm like, cool. I think I'm doing something here. I think I can really get that paycheck from USC, man. And so what happens is hopefully over just the course of this 12 weeks, they've let go, they've detached from an idea that they need to own something in a particular way, yeah? And part of that is an acculturation process, because my point of view as a participant in these dance practices is I'm not really concerned about owning the dances that I do. I'm not even concerned about owning the experience in the way that owning has been framed for us. And that really informs what I do as an artist. So, yeah, so Carly read, oh, this guy got such and such award. I can't, like, the fact that I teach at a university is kind of crazy. I have not created one dance work, one song with white people in mind. Not one. And most people think that's a negation, like, oh, he's excluding. No, I'm so deep in the wellspring of black culture, they're not there. In that cosmos, they're not there. And that isn't as political maybe as it sounds, but it's so intentional. I draw heavily from hip hop, which of course is part of a lineage of black expressive forms, right? And one thing that has always stood out for me is what I put into Funkamentals, which is the movement system that I use, and that is still like unfolding, is chaos, K-O-S, knowledge of self. So for me to continue to be about the business of learning who I am as a being in multiple worlds, as a multi-dimensional being, I have to know where the wellspring is, where the life force is, where the zero point energy is, where the dark matter is that permeates the womb universe. Yeah? And lately I've been, okay, so now let's just dive into just like the crazy dreams, my crazy dreams lately. So it's really interesting, Lene Denise is here along with Shonda Franklin. They just had a talk about archiving. And so Sun Ra is like one of the most beautiful muses of mine. And I love that he had the orchestra. And so just the background, I used to live in Philly for a while, and I was introduced to Sun Ra in Philly by my mentor, Homer Jackson, and other artists and musicians that I had the chance to work with. And so I have like, you know, have y'all ever like fell in love, like straight, like from the gate, like off the rip, like, oh man, I love you. Like, oh my God. Like, I can't even articulate and explain. Like, I love me some you. And so Sun Ra is one of those people in my life. And so Ashe the Sun Ra, Grace Jones is another, you know, person that's like, I don't know, I was a kid and I was like, I don't know what it is. And so I'm just gonna shout out some of these people, Parliament Funkadelic, George Clinton. Woo! Duke Ellington, Prince, who like, in my current work, I'm like, the more I think about some of the ideas I'm playing with, Prince is like, you know, the artist formerly known as, the artist now back as, Prince. And so I think about the arc. And so when I use this term now as sonic archivist, I realize, and it's spelled A-R-K, not A-R-C-H, I realize that some people have in their head like this image of what an archive is, right? And so I just want to be very deliberate about A-R-K as a vessel. Yeah, as a vessel, as a means to travel, yeah? And there's so many different layers on that. And to think about the arc in multiple ways, so this vessel being the body, this arc also being the bodies, and the bodies in this case being the physical body, the mental body, the etheric body, or the spirit body, the mental body, and the soul body. So those bodies and then the bodies within those bodies. To think of the frequencies that we relate to as gender, as feminine and masculine, and knowing that within this arc, those frequencies are abundant and the spectrum is not trapped in the dichotomy or the binary. Yeah, it's like infinite. And I have access to those qualities, to those attributes. And this vehicle is a vessel for those energies to be made manifest in multiple ways. Archive. I'm playing with the idea of what an archivisionary is, right? The foretelling and the forthtelling sort of prophets. Those that can see, as black folks would say, born with the veil, can see the full 360 So there's that sort of prophecy, that sort of vision. And then, of course, the foretelling. Some, you know, that beautiful skill of kind of just standing at a Trump rally, right? And going, oh, I know how we got here. And I know if this keeps going this way, where are we going? I.e. a Malcolm X. I.e. like there's so many people that have that sort of foretelling prophecy, like can just kind of read the energy, the frequency of what's going on. Yeah? So these archivisionaries. And to think about the arc, so sonic archivist as being this medium to take you from the old to the new, right? To travel from. So if you think about, you know, the stories, of course, of the Ark of the Covenant, Noah, Osiris. I mean, the story has been around for quite some time. But we think about this whole idea of chaos and moving from an old paradigm into a new paradigm. To be flooded with information, right? So once I'm flooded with information, or as Kirk Franklin has this song called, Melodies from Heaven. Rain down on me. Like when you're in that sort of part of the process where it's flooding, an arc comes in handy. Yeah. So this information, this data, these ideas, these frequencies, these energy motions, these emotions, also flood as recontextualization, as a birthing process. As before the water breaks, yeah? So the arc of the womb in this womb universe, making new, or as we say in hip hop, it's not new, like this is the first time you've seen it, but new as in fresh, like the layers of meaning that come with being fresh. Like before I came here, because I care about this moment and the people that might be here, I made sure my whole situation was fresh. Now you might not feel that, like from your perspective and from your perception, but as long as I'm in the feeling tones of like, yeah, that matters. You know what I mean? And literally it matters. It materializes. There's a frequency that comes to me and then it materializes in just taking the action of doing these things. Yeah, you follow me? We good? Call and response, people. Yo, am I here by myself? What's up? We good?
Yeah.
Good. You're talking all kinds of mumbo jumbo. All right, Ishmael Reed. All right, so anyway. Oh yeah, so let me show you some ideas of what I'm talking about. So let's dig into the archive, shall we? So I began to play with this idea of archive back in 2007-ish, late 2006, 2007, because there was this site, this user-generated media site, flipping called YouTube. And like, I literally lost my whole mind when I saw this site. Like now it's like, what was that, 2006, it was 10 years ago, right? I was like, yo, this is crazy. And then there's one artist in particular, so I'm really looking at how people are sharing these dance practices. So what was so amazing about it is my mom's from DC, my dad's from Atlanta. So I would travel in the summers to Chocolate City, DC. Someone told me the other day that they're calling it Squirrel City now, just to kind of give it a little twist, a little gentrification twist, in Atlanta. And this was the way, so the art would travel, like I would travel, and this is the way I would learn these new dances. So fly about that. I grew up in Lompoc, California. Anybody in Lompoc, California, you guys ever heard of it?
Heard of it.
Wow, we're already there, you're gonna start flying to my hometown. So I grew up in a small town. So what was really awesome is I would come back from DC or Atlanta and I have all these new dances. What? So when the cab truck came out, I was like, oh! Or the bank head bounced. When I came back with the bank head bounce, it was a wrap. And they're like, oh, that's it. Then YouTube comes out. Right? And I literally would sit. I was in graduate school then. I was supposed to be doing this work and just watch hours and hours on YouTube. And then I would keep hearing this, so I'm paying attention. So just to let you know, Black dance practices, there's a binding between music and movement that you can't separate the two. There's no idea, there's the music here, there's the dance, and we bring them together. They're already there. It's there. So I keep hearing, Soulja Boy, tell him. And see these kids like doing their dances, whatever. And I was like, yo, who the flip is this Soulja Boy dude? Months later, what happens? So I'm like, Soulja Boy up in it. Superman. And I'm like, oh, I never seen what he looked like. And I was thinking to myself, oh wow, this is really amazing. I've heard this guy's music because and then I began to kind of like gravitate to it because I would see what the bodies are doing. The bodies were like, oh, so amazing. Like, all these kids dancing, doing all these dances from down south. And I was like, it was like traveling and being there. Soulja Boy comes out. I change everything that I'm doing in grad school and write my thesis about YouTube and Soulja Boy. I got so excited. I actually wrote to teach a class at UCLA, and they were like, hell to the no, we don't even know what YouTube is. And then 2 years later, who gets asked back to be a guest speaker for a media class, and can you come in and talk about YouTube? I sure can. The difference is, what's really awesome is you get a check when you come back. See, if I'm going to be in graduate school, yo, the Most High is so amazing. They shut me down. Because I could come back and get a check. That's a cool thing. So let's dive into the archive, shall we? So I just want to show you guys some stuff. Is this the light switch here? Show you some things. Make sure I get the right one.
Is this dark enough?
This is fine, thank you very much. Is that cool for y'all? Can you see?
Yeah.
Okay. Just check out a couple things.
Yeah.
chase after you've spun so many times.
Yeah.
You start chasing things.
A year after the event, there's still no satisfactory explanation of how the Petlu Mahapi came to die. People detained by the security police have no contact with the outside world and are at the mercy of their custodians. Mrs. Hiroli Mahapi was...
Of the vote, and his supporters sent foul play. Es una vergüenza.
It's a shame that people came out to vote for Michel Martelly. It seems that the Preval government is an embarrassment to us, and it's not acceptable.
Preval se hace una vergüenza con nosotros. No puedo aceptarse.
Observers believe thousands of electors lost their right to vote because of the chaotic aftermath of January's devastating earthquake and the current outbreak of cholera in Haiti.
Thank you. Well,
pull back real quick. So you all remember the... Remember this young lady spinning? So I was at the concert and I was speaking with her mother and I just was like, she's amazing. And of course I'm recording on my phone. Yeah? And of course I'm documenting this moment for the archive. And it's really interesting how like there's a, like I don't pull my phone out much. Like to record stuff. Not like my daughter who's like, we make dinner and she's taking a picture of it, you know. But there's something about traveling, right? This sort of space and time travel that happens if you're connected in a particular way, right? So there's, at that time, I hadn't even started on this piece. But I was like, something about this is speaking to me, right? And I have this device and I can document it and I put it in the archive. It's already here in this archive. Definitely was in this, instantaneously in this archive. So the last line says, so it's about cycles. This piece is so much about cycles. And I'm gonna bring you back to one of the cuts in the cycle. So he goes, Mama told me life would be sweet, but never told me when the end would come, and like summer fun too soon, I should wait till June returns. Patiently let the cycle spin. And she's spinning. And I'm like, yo, that's it. She's saying what I'm hearing. She's the isness of what I'm feeling, right? And this cycle is really, Mark Mamuti Joseph, who's so interesting at the talk back afterwards, was like, oh, this piece is about Black joy. Right? And if you look at this collage of ideas that's happening, some people don't walk away with that. But there's so many different readings for what's going on. And it's also about just the joy of being able to get back in the mix. Like just to keep moving. So obviously there's movements of global blackness, right? So hopefully there's, you know, things are being connected in regards to our movements, just to, because, is it resistance, for lack of better words, right now? Just to resist what it feels like to resist, you know? What it feels like to toy, like, what that feels like it, I need that in that moment. To feel bodies around you, right? This collective intention that, yo, we gonna get up out of this matrix. And the fact that we just keep coming back around, like, some people call it hope, right? I don't really have the language for it, but it's something really, really amazing. And it's in that wellspring that I was talking about before. So this is called Sun Again. Also, one of the underlying ideas is to really think about rebirth in connection to patriarchy and being male-bodied. So the piece is really about talking to female-bodied people that are in my life, in this case, the daughter, who, as many black women in my life, have continued to raise me and to show me how to be born again. And then when there are those transgressions, So once again, come on down to the altar, right? And then they lay hands on the brother. And so there's so many things, but there's a piece that I did with an artist by the name of Ursula Rucker. And this piece is moving across time, back to 1999 or 2000. And I'll just play a little bit of it. It's called Brown. Uh-oh, we're trying to bomb up in here. Some of the pieces from the archive visually and hopefully sonically you heard what was going on in the music composition, like how they're reimagined, and just to give props, my partner and creative partner, Mina Murugesen, did all the visuals. And if you notice, she's been working with this really interesting technique with pegboard. So she did an exhibit, and I totally was like, yo, can I steal that? Can we do that for my piece too? Projecting a lot of these archival images through pegboard. And so like this is sort of architecture that gets set up in the space. It's kind of amazing. And gives a totally different perspective on the images. Oh, look at this guy. He's doing all kinds of other stuff because he doesn't know where the mouse is. Where the mouse at? There he is. So any questions or comments? Should we get up and dance? Like do wobble? Yes.
I'm just going to throw this out because there's so much there. I feel kind of almost overwhelmed. But the idea of the habitus or the trained body, you know, and how much you're working with, because seeing all those clips, we have a sense of kind of the ways in which we're not aware of kind of performing habitual actions, or even as a child, you know, the little girl sort of kind of, and I remember that, you know, doing those weird repetitive things. So, and then watching you kind of respond to that, I have this really strong sense of the kind of push and pull between kind of you inhabiting it and then distancing yourself the way that you use your body to kind of almost contort or move away from it. And I don't know if, you know, that's what's going on, but I thought that was incredible and very beautiful. And maybe you could talk about that or if that makes sense to you.
Yeah, I mean, if I'm steering away from what I'm interpreting, let me just go back to there's a lot of repetition.
Yeah.
And I really value repetition in a specific way, right? So in Black expressive forms, so as a musician, as a singer, and someone that grew up in the church and has kind of been in that sort of those cultural practices, and as a dance maker or a dancer, repetition, I'll put it this way. So oftentimes sometimes when I'm in a group of dance makers, for example, and if they're drawing from white Western traditions, repetition is a no-no. Unless you can like articulate just the intelligence behind it. Oh, I'm repeating this, you know, right? Right, exactly. And so when I was in graduate school getting, what an education I got in graduate school, right? I really began to value repetition because you're sitting in classes, they're drawing from traditions that you're going, huh? And then you're just not in alignment with in that way. And so fortunately, I was a grown-ass man when I went back to graduate school, and so I wasn't having it. But what was really nice is I went back to the Wellsprings, like, what is repetition in Black expressive forms? And just going back to sun again, I don't know why I just pointed because that's mountains, but that repetition is in that cyclical nature of that, right? The non-linear, right? The here, like this circle, and then there's this circle that does this, and there's that, and I might do this. And so this whole idea of newness or finding something fresh, it's just a different idea of progression, right? So the idea is, oh, I'm gonna make a dance, and it's gotta progress, because I'm so smart. I'm such a smart dance maker. So I'm gonna dance on the line, right? I'm supported by an institution, right, that hands, you know, the students a cannon, and you can either like point that cannon at yourself, anyway. or you point it away. That's what I did with the cannon. They gave me a cannon, and I was like, this is the cannon. You have to study these people. I'm horrible. I'm horrible. Forgive me. Can we just stop the tape? So what I mean
is, supposed to be in the moment. Just go with it.
Right. So the progression is everything, right? You have to progress. And what I find in Black dance practices is, and so when I say dance, I'm saying music at the same time, remember? Is that progression encompasses regression as well. Repetition, excuse me. Repetition is progression and regression. And there's something so delicious in regression that doesn't, you can't really match it up to the way, to the thought forms that are happening in these, in other practices. But what I do know is to regress, is to go back and visit. It's that Sankofa sort of principle. Go back and fetch it, right? And so, and the repetition is inhabits a kind of knowing that there's gonna be something maybe that you missed. Or there's gonna be something there new. Or when you backtrack, you know, you can do it with your eyes closed. Or wide open, or more wide open. Or covering your ears, like I'm just using all kinds of like crazy ways to just talk about that. And just to think about like succession, like what is succession in repetition? Is that remotely what you're talking about? And this sort of revisiting, right? Yeah. So to look at all of that footage as movement material, right? And then there's, just to go back to the girls' games, so if you notice that in the African clip, the boys are a part of it. In the American clip, they're not. You feel me right now? Y'all feeling what I'm, the boys are a part of it in the African clip. And then something happens in the middle passage where I can no longer participate with my sister in the same way. Yeah, it's another paradigm that says, oh, this is not a space, you know, or maybe it's a different paradigm where sisters need their space. So these are like the things that I'm thinking about. You feel me? It's not like, oh, why can't I be in it? Back in Africa, I can do it. No, like really thinking about it. Like, oh, well, wait a minute. Maybe in this matrix, the sisters need that space. What can I learn from that? What can I learn from observing? What can I learn from being a being? What can, you know, like there's so many things. And you can see even in the repetition with the Pizza Pizza Daddy O, there's this incorporation, right? So what I'm doing is nothing new and nothing fly. Because anything that you just saw in Sundaycan, they do in that circle. Any and everything. Right? I do play the fly card because I've gotten checks. Just want you guys to know that I've traveled just to whenever I want to act like I'm fly and I'm doing something creative and new. But that clip was before I was born, and any and everything that I do is in that clip. They're incorporating, you hear them, they go, pizza, pizza, now jerk it. They do the jerk, then swim in. And they're pulling in like, that probably wasn't part of the original. Then it's like, oh, who's coming in? Like, there's this awareness of, okay, wait a minute. No, you went already, like, that's that whole body's listening, those five bodies. I usually talk about this when I teach hip-hop, right? I'm not sure what hip-hop is right now. What time is it? Hold on, let me see what time is it. I don't know what hip-hop is, it's 7:07. But I was hired to teach hip-hop. So that's what I attempt to do. But it's really amazing, like there's this, that question, like if you don't own the body, can you own what the body produces? And then they come to this sort of situation, right? And to work with a generation of people that have been able to consume hip-hop dance in a way that I didn't even imagine when I was younger, right? I was late 20s, and I saw someone in the studio learning hip-hop dance, and I was like, what's going on? I can still remember like having that, like, oh, I was at Pineapple Studio in London, and I was like, whoa, they're serious. This is serious, guys, hold on. But what's interesting is that people are ready. What's happened is there's something very passive now about how people inhabit their body with these dance practices. So I go to a class, someone stands in front of the class, usually showing their booty cheeks, And then they like go through all kinds of move and the rest of it, passively learn them. Like, you know, what are you doing? Like, what are you inhabiting then? I'm just, like, these are questions I'm, you know, I think about, which is so different than what the young ladies are doing at Pizza Daddy. They are agents. They are active in it. They are listening with more than the faculties of their ears. They're aware, they're conscious in the most amazing way. And this is what I try and teach. Like, you can't, like, can you teach that? When people were like, y'all pay $12, teach me some moves to Riri's new song. And I'm like, yo, that's not what we're really doing in the hood. That's not what we're doing. We're listening. We're moving through space and through ideas, connecting. Yes.
I'm Monica. So basically what you've been talking about a lot is like what Sun Ra says about intuition, where whenever he performs out of pure intuition. He doesn't plan anything. That's why he also used a lot of dancers in his performances and stuff like that. But I also kind of liked what you were talking about when you were documenting Girl, even though you were, because sometimes I feel like iPhones get in the way of our intuition, or like sometimes YouTube and dance can get in the way of our intuition with dance. Because I grew up going to classes, and then now I'm in a phase of my dancing where I'm dancing out of pure intuition, and I'm realizing, oh, this is actually probably where I should have started, instead of like going to class and being taught what to do. But at the same time, I feel like sometimes when I'm at like a concert or performance, because we're so used to having these tools on us all the time to record things, it, you know, like I shoot concerts a lot of the time, and I'll just go to a concert and there'll be people with their phones out the whole time, and I feel like that kind of gets in the way of like our spiritual connection of intuition, but it can also aid us in a really beneficial way. So I guess this is all to ask, when you started off saying if you don't own the body, can you own what the body produces? I was wondering what you think about when your intuition produces things through either your body or also just through like mind and thoughts, and like, do you feel like you own your intuition, or does your intuition own you, or what do you think about things?
Yes, so first of all, just big ups, because you were like, let me make some connections here. Let me bring it back to Sun Ra. Let me throw in a quote. Thank you. So the key word right here is own. So I'm not even knowing it like that. I'm not worried about ownership in that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I know, right? The language trips us up.
Yeah.
Right? And I know that's probably not what you mean.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a play. There is a space to play with intuition, right? And in that field of play, right, there is so many things connected, so many things that intersect. One is vulnerability, right? One is varying degrees of just power and powerlessness. Right? Example would be acknowledging that there's a power in the surrender, and then there's something very vulnerable about just in the surrender, like to succumb to the power of what may be, right? And how that might show up on this body. Can I show you a clip?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm gonna show y'all. Can I show a little something? It became about two of us, but y'all still in the cycle. Don't get it twisted. All right. So let me see if I got it. I wonder if I did it on my other phone. But you know what's so dope? Let me just be real with y'all. I sometimes screen this in my lecture class or at my kids. It's so good to be alive because I can't find something. But I know daggone well that if I go on to YouTube, it's going to be there. Like, the cipher is real, y'all. Y'all thought it was a game? It's not a game. Okay, let's just see if I remember my password. Oh, yeah. I'm about to, like, put y'all up on game right now. I should start charging y'all right from the gate. Let me see. So while I'm getting this clip, Yeah, I think this is really, for me right now, it's about recognizing that I do not have to participate in the mythological, to go back to Sun Ra, in the mythological paradigm called white supremacy, right? Which is very clearly the manifestation of a perception disorder. Mm-hmm. Yeah? I mean, like, for real. It's a perception disorder. Mm-hmm. Oh, I see myself as, and I see you as. Mm-hmm. But I ain't really looking at me, and not showing up ain't looking at you. It's a perception disorder. Mm-hmm. And we get caught up into that. So I think that when Amelia reached out to me, like the title of this lecture was, I forgot what it was, it was something crazy. Because I just be in the moment, y'all. Y'all don't even understand. I be on some other stuff. Let me see if I can find it. Dang, and I got y'all all hyped up. Y'all ready?
That's why I like what you're saying about repetition too, because I feel like it's very intuitive to focus on progression, and that's a lot of like what capitalist society wants to emphasize, but I feel like it's also very intuitive to tap into the progression and tap into like the repetition of movement or of words and like how natural that is and how like, unnatural it is within like capitalism and elements of like white women societal structures.
Yeah, because it's about what we do, especially in this experience, is about meaning making. So when I say regression, it might not mean what you think it means. It might not mean what the global black family means. It might mean what me and my clique understand regression, right? Or like just, there's so much language, and we play with language, and corporally, there's a whole cosmos. I tell my students all the time, there's a cosmos of black dance practices that you will never see. So when your black friend goes, oh my God, you guys are taking everything appropriation, like, just tell them, hey, don't trip. There's a whole cosmos of things going on, right? I this woman came to I'm downloading the joint right now, so I'm just stalled, okay? She came to as for a guest lecture, and she was showing this clip. So she was going through certain Afro-diasporic dances, primarily in Cuba, talking about the different types of salsa. And she talks about salsa casino, and she starts breaking it down, and you know, the men, and there's a bottle, yada, yada, yada. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, I've seen that. And so I showed her this clip of these kids, right? And she was like, that's it right there, where'd you find it? And I was like, that's right there in South LA. Mm. That's called Bless the Bottle. She's like, no, this is. I was like, no, that's Bless the Bottle. And everyone in the class was like, I've never seen that before. I was like, yeah, but you ain't in the cosmos. You ain't in that cosmos. You ever seen Bless the Bottle? You ever heard of it? Yeah, little young kids ain't got no business with some gin, you know what I mean? Or cast it, pour it out for the homies, like, I have this term I call it Afrobiquity, right? Don't write that down because I need to TM that. I need to TM that. It's just so real, like it's the dark matter. You guys ever heard of colloidal silver? You guys, are you hippies? No. So, you know, colloidal, it doesn't settle. And so I think about colloidal blackness. Right? There's a blackness that's not settling. It's dispersed, right? And most people, if they have a perception disorder, they can't see it, bless their hearts. They can't see it. Now this right here is what I'm talking about. This kind of connects both of y'all's questions, hopefully. Let me get those lights. Oh, thank you. Carly, where are you going? I'm just joking, I'm not really ignorant. Carly, where are you going? Where are you moving to? Sorry, that was never inviting you back here. They're like, he's so non-academic. Oh. Yes, like an.
Right, is it just a gem?
So this is just, I think it's at somebody that calls somebody to find out. seriously, her name is Angel. So one of the other, one of my close friends, and who's also a professor down here, and y'all see the flipping mouse? Where the mouse at? Where the mouse at? I can't find the mouse. There we go, good. He had been telling me about her. And so we were just talking about catching the spirit. Like, how do you? But you don't miss that. Right? You're not making no money teaching a dance class because you can't teach that. Mm-hmm. Right? So it's already outside of the capitalist matrix. It's already outside of that. No one owns that body, right? So we're talking about possession. Right? So who possesses this body in a moment like that? What possesses a body like that? So I know you all are thinking about this body, but if you really look at the body in the room, right? There's a possession that's happening, and not like, oh, spooky, like there's something else happening that we surrender to. Intuition, right? You know what I mean? Like the language. I don't think the language is there. You all hear whose voice, even though it's a remix, whose voice was that in the song? Michael Jackson. So it's a conjuring of a spirit. Right? There's a spirit in the room, y'all. Michael? Come on now. Come on, son. Like for real, Michael? Michael's in the room. Get me. Right, we think Michael dead. Right? Y'all sitting here thinking Michael buried somewhere. Obviously not. Also, we're bringing in these thought forms, these bodies of information, right? So the ark. Yeah, so archived in this body are forms, thought forms, movement forms that were created right here. I love teaching at USC just so I can say to my students, yo, you can throw a stone and hit somebody or hit a mark where the dances that y'all want to do were created right here in your oasis. I love that. When I came to USC, they were like, USC is an oasis. Oh, oasis? What the hell? What are you saying about the neighborhood? Dang. We're going to strike that from the record as well. So, does anyone know the forms? Like, did you see her come at least out of two different dance forms? You guys recognize them? Right? So she goes into...
Robot.
Like robot. Right? Or popping with the heads. Yeah, so that's right here, L.A. Right here, L.A. Born in LA, at least born in Cal. There's definitely an argument in California right now about who gave birth, who the daddy is. But you're talking Cali steeds, and also this whole is crumping. Throw a stone, yo. It's right here. It's right here. Crumping was like 5 days old. And I was in Switzerland, and someone had a flyer up there teaching the crumpet workshop. Like 5 minutes after Rise came out, everybody giving workshops. Would y'all sit down, please, with your workshop? I saw Rise. I'm gonna teach crumpet. That's a whole different thing. And then there's that. Is that remotely approach your question? Okay, cool. The body says so much more than I could ever imagine saying, especially with this mongrel language we call English. I love to flip the script with it. And there's just so much science. If you notice, I'll go back to what's happening within the context of the studio, for example. In the studio, you're on that line again. So I talked about it being very passive, but also when it connected to, you know, you guys dance to records. You remember dancing to a record? Do you remember the flipping? You know, was the record 3 minutes long? Could be. Right? If it was a 45, right? If it was a 45, keep the math. 4 + 5 = 9. In supreme mathematics, which is all through hip-hop, which most people don't know, it's codified language, 9 = born. Right? So you can answer the 45 or 33.3. 3 + 3 + 3 = 9. Born. You have the potential to be born. Like, the science is all in the culture. It's there. And we should dance to the record, like Lene is a sonic archivist as well, and DJ, and I was sharing a poem. Part of the poem is, I come in many tongues, one spun between the sun and Shambhala, starseed, earth deed to make y'all holler. Yes, everything, yes, everything, yes, yes, y'all. 33.3 sex, the black disc revolves. Final call of alcohol, only call some seem to respond to. 33.3 sex, the record sets the tone in the zone. We all know the revolution is vinyl. The final solution is the intrusion of drum, and the DJ is the only revolutionary. Dance in trance on cue, whatever. Like, so it's like really paying respect to a different sort of pulpit that many of us went to church. And you know, there's a different relationship now for some people between, you know, just dancing to a record. That sort of repetition. Just hearing the flipping record, like when it got to the end, do you remember the sound? It was like, oh, and then repeating, picking up the needle, putting it back on the first, because that, you know, we're talking about albums that you can just listen to straight through. That sort of repetition shows up in these practices, right? And then another repetition comes from the break. You see, she was like doing faster, and then it just gets real. So there's a break, there's a repeat, there's riff, break into a whole other set of ideas that play with time and space in a different way. Mm-hmm. And that break is important. And that break comes to us in hip hop with the every like, there's so many different things. Of course, that's also part of global blackness, because we're talking about Jamaica's influence in the sound system. So it's there. Like, I ain't talking about nothing new. You know what I mean? Like, nor do I want to be talking about nothing new. I want to continue to revisit. I want to be in the wellspring. I want to get wet. Like, that whole thing right there to me is like y'all ever see people get baptized, right? When they're submerged, that whole thing is when they're submerged beneath the water. That's before you come up. That's where that whole thing happened. It was there, right? So for us as observers, we see that happen, but there's something else for the body that's under there. There's something else going on, and that's where I kind of feel like she was. You know? That place. She was out. She danced to the whole record. What dance class you been to, they danced to the whole, well, you know, line dances, they danced to the record. Anyone ever do line dances? You know, in America, they have line dances. Country line dances, usually those are synonymous with white, and then there's soul line dances. You gotta love, this is a great nation, man. This is amazing. You guys ever do a line dance?
Yeah.
We should flip and do one. Let's do one. You guys got any more questions? I want to dance with you. Can we dance? Why not? Let's do a line dance. Let's just like really feel it on our bodies, what it means to circulate, basically. So we'll do this mind dance together. Y'all, why are you looking at me like that? Why are you looking
I'm waiting
like
for
that?
The needle to be
dropped. Okay. Yeah. All right, so we're going to do this line dance, and we're going to do what I call a wireless transmission. Okay? There'll be no instruction, at least quote unquote formal instruction. And I'm. Show enough ain't gonna count you in. 5, 6, let's go. No, definitely ain't happening. So we're gonna do like humans have been doing for a long time, and what's really an amazing part of Black expressive forms is we're gonna do this wireless transmission. You're gonna listen, you're gonna pay attention. You're gonna get in where you fit in, yes? And the movement sequence is so simple because it's like laying brick and mortar. It's very basic, so you can build on it. You build on it by throwing your swag on it, your flavor, your stank, your funk, your drop, right? Show your whole booty crack. Let's do it. So let's do, okay, I know what we're gonna do. Why not? Let's just do something there. Okay, yeah, okay, that's what we're gonna do. That's it, that's what we're gonna do. Are we gonna stand up? Y'all gonna be some chair dances? Let's do it. Yeah, let's Let's move these first two rows back, shall we? Just give myself some room. Okay. Oh, y'all really making space over there. We about to kick some stuff over. I love it. We have to rename this from Rosky Talks to
Rosky Dance.
Rosky Moves.
Rosky Dance.
Rosky Drop It Like It's Hot or something. Rosky, we gon' Rosky it. It'll become a verb. Alright, y'all ready? Some of y'all might already know this, which is beautiful.
Okay,
you
were just clicking on and off like
you have. How am I supposed to get it?
All right, here we go. What are we doing? The Soul Train line? Let's dance this. We can fill in the space. Hey, this guy, what are you doing? What are you doing with yourself? What are you doing with yourself? You locking up. You like, you ain't going to dance. You trying to get out of here?
No, I'm trying to scare everything over.
You want to, kick your camera? So, yeah, just fill in the space. We'll start facing this way, and then it's going, we're going to circulate.
You know.
There's that whole idea of individuation, like I can see who you are. Like we're all doing the same steps and I can see and hear and feel you and you and you, and there's space for that, right? No robotic, we all look the same. We dance to a whole 6, almost 7 minute rocket jump, right? You listen, you become more attentive, right? I don't know this dance. So you can pay attention, some of y'all are craning your neck around just to find out. You get in where you fit in. No one stops you at the party and goes, hey, I really like the dance you're doing. Could you just stop enjoying yourself so I can learn it? Like, there's a sort of sensitivity that happens, and you kind of know that I'm going to pay attention, I'm going to listen, which is so amazing. And we literally are the body that circulates 360, just like the record. So-called four-wall line dance, but we're like moving. So I'm no longer the center of attention, yeah? We're here, we start here, and then you turn here, and then some of you are like, what are you doing, right? So the whole, a different sort of hierarchy is set up, yeah, or broken down. And the community just continues to teach me. I feel so grateful that, you know, like I said, I could throw a stone and there's so much to learn right here in this neighborhood. That feeds me and hopefully feeds the people that come through what we call a class, or what I call a cipher. Circulate information and knowledge under the assumption that everyone that comes has something to offer. So something to give, something to receive. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Just like everyone that came in today, I really appreciate you. Thank you so much.
That was
Thank you
awesome.
For having me.
Thank you.